New Hope TV, your encounter with God.
I have a very simple word today. It's a very, very simple word. But I believe that it is a word from the Lord. And therefore, you and I must listen to it. And it's from Psalm 19 and verse 14. It says there, "Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer." Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. The word is so simple that you don't have to go and fast for another 21 days so that you'll get the strength to apply today's word. By the grace of God, you can start using it the moment we finish this meeting. In fact, we are going to do a bit of practice using this word before we leave the meeting. Close your eyes, raise your hand and pray, "Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and my redeemer." I know, you know, all of us sitting here know the power of words, right? All of us know. I mean, it's not new to anybody sitting here. I know that. Okay, but some things are worth reminding ourselves. And I believe the Lord wants to do that today. Our words have power. They can influence. They can determine. Which means our words have power to influence and determine our destiny. Our words have power and influence to determine the destiny of people around us. Our words are very powerful. I want to talk about words in relation to ourselves, words in relation to people around us, and words in relation to God. Our words can have a positive or a negative impact on us, first of all. It can be a short-term impact, it can be a very long-term impact. What we say. In Numbers 12, two people spoke only 15 words. "Has the Lord indeed spoken only through Moses? Has he not spoken through us also?" 15 words. Just 15 words. Maybe, you know, depending on the translation, okay, the version that you have, it may be plus or minus a word or two. But God heard those words, those 15 words. And suddenly, when Aaron turns around, he's seeing Miriam full of leprosy. And she became a leper. And she was shut out, we know the story, she was shut out of the camp for 7 days. No contact with anyone. You may wonder what got into Miriam's head. When she can clearly see Moses and everything that happened before they crossed over. How God, you know, all the things that Moses did with Pharaoh and, at, you know, the passing of the angel of death. She's seen all that, and what got into Miriam's head that day? Do you think you and I would have done Miriam's mistake? If we were in Miriam's shoe, how likely is it that we may have committed the same error? If you think zero chance, then it's a very high chance that you would have committed that mistake. Because we are all capable of thinking like that in a moment of weakness. Actually, Miriam had a reason to think like that. If you read Exodus 15:20, you find that Miriam was a prophetess. Miriam was a prophetess who got word from God and gave to people. The word says, "Then Miriam, the prophetess, the sister of Aaron, took the timbrel in her hand, and the woman went out after her with timbrels and with dances." So Miriam was a prophetess. No wonder she said, "Has God spoken only through Moses?" We know that God's plan was to deliver Israel from the hand of Egypt through Moses, yes. But if you turn to Micah chapter 6 and verse 4, okay, you find that God in his plan did not just send Moses ahead of the Israelites. He sent Moses, he sent Aaron, and he sent Miriam before the Israelites. God did not send just one man, he sent three people before the Israelites. Now, if you and I were one of those three, do you think it's zero chance that we would have spoken? No, a very high chance, right? Three people appointed by God to go before the Israel. On top of that, I am prophet or prophetess. Do you think we would have made that mistake? What a family. One is a lawgiver, the other is a priest, and the third is a prophetess. I mean, what a family. What a family. So what is wrong when Miriam used some unwise words? Or used some words which we all agree, you know, we may have said that. What was wrong? She forgot her position. Moses was not just a lawgiver. Moses was also a priest. If you read Psalm 99:6, I'm not going to read it. Psalm 99 says Moses was a priest also. Moses was a lawgiver. He was a priest. Okay? And then God himself says, I talk to him face to face. So he's a prophet. Why did Miriam turn leprous? She was unable to function under leadership. She was murmuring against leadership. Her words were not acceptable to the Lord because God put this person on top of her and she is now murmuring against God-given authority. When any young person talks against leadership, you know, you can be sure that person is not ready for leadership anytime now. Right? It'll take a long, may eventually become, but it'll take time for that person to mature, understand that you can become only a good leader if you're a good follower. Right? Miriam had not learned that lesson. So she started murmuring. But think, look at Joshua. Joshua is the person who wrote the book of Joshua. In fact, he wrote most of the book of Joshua, except the last parts which talk about his death and all that. So Joshua is the author of the book of Joshua. And do you know how he describes himself? In Joshua 1:1, he describes himself as a servant or an assistant to Moses. Not the great army commander. Not the great, you know, triumphant victory in battle. No, he says, I am a servant of Moses. I'm an assistant to Moses. I'm an aide to Moses. We know exaltation comes from the Lord. And when Joshua writes about himself, he says in 4:14, on that day, the Lord exalted Joshua. He's not, you know, exalted me. The Lord exalted Joshua. And only at the end, after Joshua dies, you find the servant of Moses becoming the servant of God. Joshua, the servant of God. And that was written by somebody else, not by him. He said, I'm Moses' servant. It is enough. Miriam wanted to become equal with Moses. So, you know, wrong motives, wrong understanding of who we are can lead us to sometimes say the wrong things, especially against people in authority, against people whom God has placed over us. We should be very, very careful. And we may have all made mistakes in that area. So it's a good time when we get back home to, you know, kind of reflect on that and maybe confess our error. You know, God is faithful to forgive, right? I want to ask you one more thing. It says in Numbers 12:2, has the Lord indeed spoken only through Moses? Has he not spoken through us also? Through us, which means there is Miriam and there is Aaron. How come only Miriam became leprous? Two people said, has not God spoken? How come only Miriam? You know, God is no respecter of persons or sexes for that matter. Did he have something against Miriam? Why did God not strike Aaron with leprosy? He also thought the same thing. For two reasons, okay? And because it's not the main point of the message. One is, if you read Numbers 12:1, it's the only place in the Bible where Miriam is named before Aaron. Everywhere else, Aaron is the eldest brother. So Aaron comes, is named before Miriam. But where it comes to this complaining, right? Miriam takes the lead. So the punishment is directly linked to, proportionate to the role that you played in creating this small discussion and complaining against God. Two, when I was studying, I learned this. That word spoke against Moses, it's actually a feminine word. It's used when women speak, not when men speak. So actually, even though both of them thought about it, it was Miriam who actually spoke those words. Let the words of my mouth be acceptable in thy sight. Aaron, by the grace of God, agreed, but he kept quiet. Miriam spoke. Right? There are many things we ask, it's better to keep quiet, right? Third thing, Aaron was Israel's high priest. A high priest with leprosy cannot come before God and plead for the people. So to keep that door open, God spared Aaron. Of course, it was Moses who prayed, but Moses is really standing there as God's representative. So for these three reasons, very good reasons, kindly reasons, gracious reasons, the Lord did not strike Aaron with leprosy. The point is, if speaking 15 wrong words can get you leprosy, we have to be very careful with our words. And we can justly think that it is Old Testament, right? You can justly think that is, that God is not this God, right? But has God changed? No. I mean, as Pastor Raj was sharing on Friday evening, the New Testament is actually a lot tougher than the Old Testament. We think it's grace, 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 but the New Testament is actually a lot tougher than, I mean, we don't realize it's a lot more tougher than the Old Testament. In the Old Testament, if you committed adultery, you had a problem. Jesus said, if you look at a, so which is tougher, right? In the Old Testament, if you committed murder, you were in deep problem. Jesus said, if you're angry with your brother, so which is tougher, Old Testament or New Testament? So we have to be doubly careful in this New Testament time about the words we use. Miriam's punishment lasted only 7 days in the Old Testament. Right? When the angel of the Lord came to Zechariah and announced that, you know, you and Elizabeth are going to have a child and John the Baptist is going to come, Zechariah doubted the word of God, right? His punishment lasted some 38 weeks, right? The entire term of the pregnancy. Old Testament was only 7 days punishment. This was for 38 weeks, 36, 38 weeks, he could not speak. Let the words of my mouth be acceptable in thy sight. You know, in the Old Testament, there's a scene where Elisha tells the king that tomorrow, 2 Kings chapter 7, tomorrow this time, a, a seer of fine flour shall be sold for a shekel. You know that time when there was a famine and Elisha sends, the king comes to meet Elisha and Elisha gives a word that tomorrow this time, all this will change and you will have abundance, right? Two seers of barley for a shekel at the gate of Samaria. All things are going to change overnight. Tomorrow, this within 24 hours, things will, right now it's, you can see only famine, but tomorrow, this is the word of God. And there was a man with the king. Okay, it says, on whose hand the king leaned on. So he was really the king's walking stick. That's his job, to be the king's walking stick. A walking stick is supposed to be a walking stick. Instead of being a walking stick, he opened his mouth. And he said, look, if the, he's telling the prophet, look, if the windows, if the Lord would make windows in heaven, the Lord has already made windows in heaven, but he's saying, if the Lord would make windows in heaven, could this thing be? And you know what Elisha told him? You will see this with your eyes, but you shall not eat of it. He could have just kept quiet. A prophet is and a king are having a discussion. He interferes in the It's like, you know, the Prime Minister of India and the Prime Minister of Pakistan are talking and there's somebody who's taking the minutes of the meeting and there's a, some, you know, discussions are going, some negotiations going on and this guy has a brainwave and he wants to show the, both the countries who is the wisest of them and he opens his mouth. I bet you can send a note to the Prime Minister, you know, maybe you want to look at this or, you know, some, he opens his mouth. You shall see with your eyes, but you shall not eat of it. Let the words of my mouth be acceptable in your sight. You know, it's good to keep quiet, or it's even better to, you know, say, like, you know, when the Lord asked Ezekiel, son of man, can these bones live? I answered, oh Lord, you know. Right? You know. I don't know. You know. It's a safe answer. What you say, you know all things. I agree with whatever you say. When the man of God pronounces a blessing, how difficult is it for you and me to say amen? What does it cost us to say amen? Instead of sitting there and wondering, how is this thing going to be like Zechariah? Will this really happen? Right? When God has sent a word through the man of God or the woman of God, who are the Lord has chosen, and we, and it's a blessing. I mean, the easiest thing for us to just say is amen. I receive it, right? I receive it. But if you're saying, you know, this is too much, we have already lost it. We will not see it. We'll see it happening for other people, but we may not eat it. The Lord will not kill us, but you know, we may not eat of it. It's important to speak right, especially before God. When He sends His word, we have to speak right before Him. Job's wife said, curse God and die. Job said, no. I'll rather sit and keep scratching, right, in the ash heap, but I will not sin with my mouth. In Malachi 3:13, the Lord says something. Your words, He's telling His people, your words have been harsh against me. The words of mortal man and woman, God says, have been too harsh against Him. Instead of praising God for His goodness, instead of, you know, magnifying Him, instead of worshiping Him in and through that difficult time, we, you know, if we speak harsh words against God, He notices. He hears those words and He says, it's there, Malachi 3:13, your words have been too harsh against me. Right? Because we serve a good God. Ecclesiastes 5:2 has good instruction for us. Do not be quick with your mouth. Do not be hasty in your heart to utter anything before God. God is in heaven and you are on earth, let your words be few. Right? God is in heaven, you are on earth, let your words be few. Sometimes, you know, we say things we don't know what we are saying. Just the way, you know, Peter on the Mount of Transfiguration says, Lord, let us build 3 tabernacles. One for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. It says there in verse 6 of Mark 9, because he did not know what to say. Because he did not know what to say, you can keep quiet, but he blurts it out. It's not Peter, it's you and me, really, right? When we don't know what to say, we just say something. And the cloud came over and overshadowed them, saying, this is my beloved son, hear him. Right? Hear him. Job 38:2. Who is this who darkens counsel by words without knowledge? When God starts speaking to Job, one of the first things he asks is, who is this who darkens counsel by words without knowledge? Asking Job, not to any of the other guys. He's asking Job, who, you know, mostly kept saying the right things. But somewhere he tripped. And God is saying, why are you saying things, you know, foolish things without knowledge? James chapter 3 verse 2. For we all stumble in many things. If anyone does not stumble in word, he is a perfect man, able also to bridle the whole body. If anyone does not stumble in his word, James writes, he is a perfect man. For we all see, it's not, he's not talking that, you know, we are perfect, we are sinless, because he himself just said, we all stumble in many things. He just said that. And after that he's saying, but if you are able to hold your tongue, you are a perfect man. In the sense, you have control. You have control over yourself. You have control over your being. Right? If you can control your tongue. He's not saying you're sinless. No, that's not the meaning of perfect there. He's just saying you can, you have control. You're not loose, you know. To the church those days, to the early church, James writes, out of the same mouth proceeds blessing and cursing. You think it's a historic problem once upon a time in the church? Out of the same mouth proceeds blessing and cursing. And he says, these things ought not to be. These things ought not to be so. We have a fountain of living water. Rivers of living water. Let's not mix some dead water along when it comes out. It's for all of us, for me. Right? Out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. And that's the water that we have, really. We mustn't allow the devil to dig a hole and supply some adulterated water. James also writes, let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger. We haven't heard these words for a long time. I haven't. So, you know, it's good for all of us, I guess. Let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, and slow to anger. There are a lot of verses. There are a lot of verses. I'm not, you know, getting into all that. You know, they're short. I just want to keep it short. Okay? Let his words be few. I want to try and keep my words few, you know. There are lots of verses. You can, you know, search them through the concordance. You know, once a young man went to Socrates to learn the art of oratory. So after his, there were a few of them who had come to him to learn. To one guy, he said, he quoted the fees. He quoted the fees to everyone. To one guy, he said, you have to pay me double. Right? So that guy said, you know, it's not fair. You're asking everyone for the same course, you're asking the same, you know, X amount of fees for everyone. And for me, you're asking 2X. Why? I said, I have to first teach you how to keep quiet. Before I teach you how to start speaking, I have to first teach you how to keep quiet.